The wristbands, this is our security token. If you see people on the camping site that do not have a wristband, please refer them to the info booth so they can register themselves and make sure that we know who everybody is. We have plenty of materials here that we don't want to get stolen. If everybody wants to be a bit of security to check whether everybody's got their wristbands, please send them to the info booth available. The other side, we've got plenty of space left on the wristbands. This is something for the moms and dads. Please write your child's name on it and write your cell phone number on it as well. In case some child is in panic or is lost or whatever, we find them, that the people that find them can contact you as the parents, and that at least we can retrieve your children in a safe way. So that is, please everybody do this. Make sure that your children are marked. Okay, the central part of all organizational things is the info booth, is those tables there. If you want to register, if you want to buy tokens, if some kind of information you need, if you're a speaker and you want to get your location organized and want to talk about your content, that will be organized here at the info booth. Also, if you find a wallet, I know somebody's glasses already lost, if you find stuff, please bring it here. We'll have a lost and found here as well. We have a lost and found on the wiki as well. But I still have to link it to the floor. Okay, and then I have one final rule. Please, everybody, obey gravity. It is the law. Okay. I want to... I'm a few minutes over time. Okay, so that's perfect. I want to announce our first speaker. Where is Jan? Dennis Jan. Alright. I want to announce our first speaker, Jan de Koster. Jan is a huge fan of robots, and not just robots, not just the technical side of robots, not just the how do we make a robot, how do we do so. Jan is also, because of all his experience with working with robots, working with expression in robots, is that correct, Jan? And he's working with emotion in robots, he's trying to understand the psychology of robots, and he's going to give us a talk about the robots. Before he begins, I want to say something to children. Kinderen, die meneer hier gaat een verhaal vertellen over de ziel van de robot. Hij gaat heel wat mooie foto's laten zien door robots, maar hij zal wel zijn verhaal een beetje in het Engels doen. Maar dat is niet erg, jullie kunnen hier komen kijken naar de robot. En wat wij heel graag zouden hebben van jullie, dat is de eerste taak die wij nu geven, is wij hebben daar een hele lange tafel vol wit papier hiernaast. Ja? En daar liggen allemaal stiften en knutselspullen op. En we zouden graag hebben dat jullie hier naar komen kijken naar de foto's die Jan meegebracht heeft van robots. En dat jullie met die tekeningen en die ideeën een hele tafel vol met robots kunnen. Kunnen jullie dat? Ja? En zij die willen, kunnen natuurlijk naar Jan luisteren. En misschien mama of papa wil dan misschien wel helpen vertellen wat het is. Oké. Without further ado, please welcome Jan.
So, good morning everybody. Thank you, Anthony, for the introduction. It was about 1 year ago when you first said to me, let's do our own camp in Belgium, and he pulled it off. It's great that he imagined. Of course, there's a lot of people helping him, but the driving force here is, of course, Anthony. My studio is called Slightly Overdone, and I'll tell you a little bit about the work I'm working on and the robots I'm building. So this is also a commercial studio, so if some of the messages and movies and slides seem a little bit on the commercial side and it looks like I'm trying to sell you something, it's because I use this presentation for clients too, so bear with me, sorry for that part, but sometimes it will look a little bit commercial. So I have a background in physics, and this is one of my big examples in life, Richard Feynman, mainly because one of his quotes, which is maybe a little bit early for some of you, but I'll show it anyway because it's really important for as an inspiration in some of my projects. Science is like sex, sometimes something useful comes out, but that's not really the reason why we are doing it. And that is very often the case with projects I'm working on, like Peter Pumpkinhead here, we built him about a year ago. It looks like a cool idea to work on, and you don't know why we started this. It's because we planted about 20 pumpkin seeds and only one pumpkin came out, so it had to become a robot. And then we posted it on Make magazine about 2 days before Halloween, and they picked it up because there were a lot of robot pumpkins on their site back then. And we stayed in touch, and I'm collaborating on the Make website right now and writing articles for them, which is a huge honor for me, this old guy in Belgium. And they even showed it on Discovery Channel Canada a day later, from just one stupid pumpkin with eyes in it. The first robot I could work on was this one, Yummy. I'm sorry I couldn't bring any robots here. We have one parking the car right now, but he doesn't like the cargo bikes, so he's staying there for a while. We'll see him later in the presentation. But this was the first one, Yummy. I got to build him for the campaign of Deleuze about 2.5 years ago. I'll show you my timeline in the meantime. Okay, so I had been building physical interactive installations for about 15 years now. I also developed an interest in character design, in designing and drawing characters for games I was working on. I had a career of about 7 years in advertising at BBDO. There I was designing a lot of characters for games. So when they asked me to build a robot, these were these two big interests of mine, physical installations and characters that were coming together. Although I had never built a robot before, it was an opportunity I could not miss pass on. So I said, yes, of course I'll build it. Well, we need it in 4 weeks, okay. Still, I'll build it, and also it has to move as a moving face and an arm that can take off a hat. So this was a briefing I got. So because there was very little time to make all this, I had to build many of these parts myself, because ordering professional robot parts from the States or from Asia would take a lot longer than just these 4 weeks. So here I'm testing the first prototype of the arm, which looks pretty ridiculous looking at it right now, almost 3 years later, but still it did the job back then. I had a camera around in the studio this whole 4 weeks because the client thought it was really important that they could show the process of building this robot, because they could just as well have asked a CG artist to make a 3D robot and make all the shots for the website in CG. But then they wouldn't have this video of some guy making in the veranda making this robot. This was of big importance for them, because that gave him texture, that gave him a background, a story, and something they could show to their clients that they really care about this character. The only part I really designed myself was his face. This was laser cut and machine built. All the other parts I just had to find in kitchen stores and in Innovation and in IKEA. These were the kind of mockups I was making and showing to the client. And they said it's nice, but it looks like a trash can, so go look for other parts. Then I went to the robot torso store, which is the common work, and I found the torso there on the right, which is a Philips blender, surprisingly, but I still believe they were building robots at one point and then reused some of the parts to make blenders, because it's just the perfect torso. Eyes are really important, of course, so I spend a lot of time at the Veritas choosing black buttons and then finding the right balance between the white of the eye and the black pupil. And then there was the final day, 4 weeks later, when I placed everything together. And he looked at me for the very first time. It was a really special moment. I didn't see coming, but we had this really emotional link at that moment. Of course, I had been spending day and night for 4 weeks with this project, so I wasn't probably thinking all too clear at that time, but still this link, this connection we made is still there right now, and it's not just something that that we come to overworking and some over-emotional link with the project back then. So, I'll come back to that later. I learned everything I know about character design at Victor Plasma, which is a conference that's held every year in Berlin for 10 years now, about character design. All the great artists from all over the world that are making design and illustrating characters are there every year. And I had some trouble finding my place there because I wasn't really drawing by hand or illustrating. I was making robots. So it was a really big honor for me. And they asked me last year to come back and present Yumi there between all the other artists. Because they accepted me as one of the character designers among them. So if you think about robots and what their qualities are, people think about, of course, perfection. They have a function, they have a certain quality, and they are certainly flawless. But Yumi had none of these qualities. So was this really a robot, or was it some kind of hobby project that came that grew out of hand? Yumi had other qualities that people seemed to like, which was his imperfection and the kind of empathy he showed to people, the flaws he had. Every time I made a scratch in the paint or made a mistake somewhere, I was really nervous to show this to the clients, and they really liked it because as long as they had these marks and these showed them the people that this was really a real physical object. So I decided at that moment that I wanted to keep building robots. It was my new thing. I was going to become a robot builder. Even if I had to fake this for a while, I was faking I was a robot builder. So this was the next robot I built, Bird. So the first idea to build him was because Yumi was too big to carry around everywhere, so I needed a smaller robot. And a round skull was a cool idea to work with. He needed a little bit more attitude and character to him than Yumi. That's where all the details came from. If you're a character designer, it's very normal that after a while, if you're developing a character, the story starts to develop by itself and it starts to talk back to you to complete this story. So if you make a character like Herb, he tells you he likes messy black hair and jeans and this kind of rubber jacket look. It's really, really normal. It's not a sign of a mental defect. It happens a lot by calling it character designs. So these are the inspirations probably for him. I was born in the 70s, so the Muppets are coolest thing that were around back then, monsters in one eye, and then of course the Wolverine inspiration in the middle because of his hairdo. I had this fake fur lying around and I thought I'll just place that on there and then take my razor and shape it the way I think it would look nice, but Bert told me this is the look I'm going for. You put that razor away, the messier it gets, the better. And he likes to make really bad friends. This is him at the home conference last year. These are the two toughest guys around back then. The Stormtrooper was really a really friendly guy. The Bert was. And they really like this learning name, by the way, when that happens.